Yahya Ibrahim, who is joining us from Perth, Western Australia. And just some information on Sheikh Yahya. He was born in Canada, but he's traveled throughout the world. He's been to Australia, Africa, Southeast Asia, Europe, and Canada, delivering lectures to Muslims and non-Muslim audiences. At the age of 16, oh, there we go, Sheikh shows up. At the age of 16, he memorized the Quran, or he started memorizing the Quran. He completed it in just 20 months. He received his ijazah and certification to teach. He began lecturing at the age of 17, and he's been involved in the Islamic community since 1993. So the topic today that he's going to be covering is mental health during COVID. And as you guys know, this is really important during these times. Inshallah, without further ado, Sheikh Yahya Ibrahim.
Jazakallah khair. All right. Allahumma salli ala nabiyyina Muhammad. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah, hamd al-shakirin wa salatu wa salamu ala sayyid al-mursaleen, sayyidina wa nabiyyina wa habibina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim tasliman kathira. Allahumma salli wa sallim wa zid wa barik ala sayyidina wa habibina wa nabiyyina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim. It's a pleasure and honor, alhamdulillah, to be able to connect to you, even though if it's virtually and from a distance. I come to you from a corner of our living room here in Perth in Western Australia. And I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has gathered us from our different localities, our different time zones, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always gathers us physically or virtually in that which is pleasing to Him, in His ta'a. And that if we don't get to meet in this dunya, again, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows us to reconnect with the best of people, our Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and all of us together in Jannatul Firdaus, Allahumma Ameen. It's an honor and a privilege, alhamdulillah, to have a few minutes to speak about mental health. Not just in the context of a COVID response, but just in general, it is important for us as Muslims to speak about mental health as it is something that was prominent in the lifestyle and the times of the Prophet ﷺ. So you see that the Prophet ﷺ wanted to take care of his community. There were people in it who were balanced, and there were also people who lived in his time who were unbalanced. And when I say those who were experiencing an imbalance due to the stress or due to pain, you find a wide cross-section of hadith where the Prophet ﷺ would react in particular ways. So one hadith in Sahih Muslim that there was a woman, radiallahu anha wa ghafarallahu lana wa laha, one of the sahabiyat of the Prophet ﷺ, who was known to have an adverse mental health condition. She was a person who was consistently just talking, just wouldn't stop. You know, people at times you see them on a corner just rambling. So she's one of these people. And she stops the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam after the prayer as he's leaving the masjid. And she says, "Uridu minka kalima." I want to take a word from you, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has a sadrun rahib. You know, he's a person who welcomes all in all times, in all conditions, in all circumstances, for all reasons. But the lady had stopped him right at the entrance of the masjid in the pathway where people are going back and forth. And we know from the sunnah, إِيَّاكُمْ وَالْجُلُوسِ عَلَى الطُّرُقَاتِ. We don't frequent sitting, blocking access and passageways. We don't sit there or congregate there. So the Prophet ﷺ says in one type of riwayah, in one discussion, he says, look, خَلِّ الطَّرِيقِ, let's move out of the path of people and take many words from me. Take as many words as you would like. And he stood with her, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in some narrations between Dhuhr and Asr. So he spent a considerable time with somebody that other people would push to the sides of the pathway and ignore. But our Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there were moments where he came upon one of the women of the Sahaba who had lost her husband. In one of the battles, istushid, he was martyred, and she was by his graveside, and she was weeping, and she didn't know that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the one who, with his companions, had come up upon her, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, commands her to patience, and she doesn't turn around to see who it is, she doesn't hear the voice clearly, it's dark, you know, there's so many reasons, And she just says, leave me alone. You don't know what I'm dealing with. You don't know the pain that I'm experiencing. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam moves back, orders the Sahaba to move back. Nobody says, hey, don't you know who you're speaking to? This is the Messenger of Allah. He can make dua. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, leave her to grieve and leave her with her pain for a few moments. And on authentic hadith, also in Sahih Muslim, we see that there was a man who used to frequent the masjid by holding his son's hand, yashabahu ila al-masjid. He would walk with his son hand in hand to the masjid. His son was, 3, 4, 5 years old. And subhanAllah, the Prophet misses this man, misses his boy coming to the masjid, doesn't see them for 1 day, 2 days, 3 days, and asks, where are they? And they say to him, Ya Rasulallah, qad mata waladu. His son, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect our homes and your homes from ever experiencing this. He's lost his son. وَقَدْ حَبَسَ نَفْسَهُ. He's locked himself in his home. He's not eating, he's not drinking, he's not bathing, he's not praying. He's not coming to the jama'ah. Because back then it was unheard of that somebody would just pray at home, right? So, he was somebody who left prayer in jama'ah behind Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to visit him. And, we get this inspiration from the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that he would visit people in whatever stresses that they were in. The famous hadith of Abu Umair, the brother of Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, he was maybe 4 years old. He was just off weaning. His mom had just stopped feeding him. So maybe he's now 3, 4 years old, just growing as a young child. And he used to have Nu'ayr, a little sparrow that he had a cage for it and would feed it. And when Anas says to the Prophet ﷺ that the bird died and his son Abu Umair, his brother Abu Umair is upset, the Prophet went to the home and made ta'ziyah and said, Ya Abu Umair, ماذا فعل النعير? What happened to your bird? So the Prophet would visit and check in on people and do these kind of things. So we know that there was a response that you can see in the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, a communal issue and things like that. And I want to address that as we proceed, inshallah. But I wish to speak about building resilience in mental health. So I don't want to itemize what are some of the feelings people display. And these are things, of course, that all of us, at times we get down and we get sad and we get upset and we get a level of depression. There's a difference between being depressed and being clinically depressed. There's a difference between the word huzn and hazan in the Arabic language, and the depression that is a clinical depression that is a persistent, more than 2 week journey, unable to get out of bed, haven't eaten, haven't drunk, that kind of thing is different to the context that it's sometimes we read in the hadith. Because sometimes there's this confusion where, oh, if I make this dua, it removes depression. You find it in Hisnul Muslim, the dua that removes depression. Allahumma inni abduk ibn abdik ibn amatik, nasiyati biyadik, nazil fiyya hukmuk, adlum fiyya qada'uk, as'aluka bi kulli ismin huwa lak, sammayta bihi nafsak, anzaltahu fi kitabik, allamtahu ahadan min khalqik, an taj'al al-Qur'an al-azima rabi'a qulubina, wa dhahaba humumina. وَغُمُومِنَا يَا أَرْحَمَ الرَّاحِمِينَ. So this hadith was taught to remove sadness. But that sadness is limited to a sadness that one is coping with, that is non-permanent in its nature, that isn't of a mental health issue, that is a clinical issue in that sense. So I want to separate between the two so that people are not misunderstanding the context of our discussion. The mental health issues that I'm speaking about are ones that all of us endure and the ones that all of us will experience. There will be moments where we enter into happiness and then move out of it and move back in towards it. The Prophet ﷺ, at the loss of Khadija radiallahu anha, at the loss of his uncle, it's not known as the day of sadness or a week of sadness or a month of sadness. It's known as Aam al-Huzn, a month of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam experiencing that moment of strain and difficulty where he had to develop resilience. And this is the word. So one of the hallmarks of prophethood and one of the teachable aspects of faith is the demonstration of resilience. Now there are a number of words that we use to describe sabr. The best of them, in my opinion, as a translation of the concept of sabr, not just a translation, but the concept of sabr, is resilience. And if we were to define resilience, It's that we understand that, so psychologists, for example, will define it in a particular way. It's a process of adapting to, in the face of adversity, trauma, tragedy, threats, hardships, significant stress and loss, to being able to navigate through it and overcome it. And resilience means it is a process of fighting back against those emotions that want to bring you down and hold you down and make you incapacitated. Resilience is something that is taught to us in each of the five pillars of our faith. Yani as-sabr is built into everything that we do as Muslims. Sabr in siyam. You know, the month of Ramadan is called the month of sabr. Shahru sabr, one of its nicknames. Salah is sabr. Wa innaha lakabira illa ala al-khashi'in. It's an enormous, it's such a difficult task. You have to be patient to endure it. As-sabr ala al-ma'mur. Patience in the things you are ordered to fulfill. Sabr is definitely a part of your hajj journey. Subhanallah. Isbiru, right? La rafatha wa la fusuqa wa la jidal. No arguing. No. Look at the things that Allah commands you not to do in hajj. Have patience with your sexual desires. Hold back your tongue and don't argue, even if you're right. Like, just be quiet. Just hold it in. Be resilient in the face of what will occur. And of course, in zakah, you know, knowing that your wealth is going to somebody else, and we all work hard for it, and subhanallah, we all hope that Allah returns it to us, adha'afan mudha'afa. But there's an element of resilience that is established in it. And it's important, therefore, to understand that whatever adverse events, COVID-19, loss of one's job, family dissension and difficulty, the trauma, the car wreck of divorce, when it is done in a way that is unsupported and beyond the capacity of a wakeful heart, and there isn't leadership that leads a process to clarity and ease, all of those become severe, severe issues. But in particular, I'm speaking to a younger audience. And I want to define what is resilience as it is for somebody who's beginning their life. Somebody who is not necessarily in the need of looking after others, but is in the occupation of being primarily occupied by looking after themselves. Being resilient doesn't mean that you will not experience difficulty. And therefore, the life of the prophets is defined, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa ala al-anbiya'i ajma'in wa rusulihi al-kiram, that their whole life is defined as journeys of patience, journeys of resilience, journeys of proving that if you hold firm, if you are resolute, if you are resilient, if you are commanding sabr, فَإِنَّ ذَٰلِكَ مِنْ عَزْمِ الْأُمُورِ, that will be of the things of the greatest import in your life and my life. The Prophet ﷺ says in the authentic hadith of Imam Muslim from Umar radiallahu anhu, مَا أُعْطَى عَبْدًا عَطَاءً أَوْسَعَ وَلَا أَنْفَعَ وَلَا أَبْلَغَ مِنَ الصَّبْرِ. No human being has been given anything that's more comprehensive, more prevalent, more beneficial, more important in all of the different dimensions of their life than to develop and have a capacity of patience. Patience is the root of al-mahamid, of all of the things that we praise. Courage is because you're patient. What makes a person brave is that they're able to go beyond where other people stop. The person who rushes into that building that is on fire and other people don't is because they're able to withstand and hold away their fear to go and commit themselves to others. What makes a mujahid, one who struggles in the defense of his people, of his family, of his countrymen, of his land, a noble person that we witness that they are sacrificing themselves for the path of God and of the establishment of truth, is that they're able to do what other people cower from and are unable to move forward in. So resilience isn't that you won't experience difficulty, it's that you respond to it with nobility. Is that you train yourself through incremental processes to gaining ascendancy, success. Now, I know you guys are in California. There was actually an experiment. It's called the marshmallow experiment. Anybody who studied a little bit of psychology or begins to understand a little bit about the growth mindset and so on, There was an experiment done in the 50s, 60s, where they would bring young kids in and they would sit them in a room and they'd have a camera filming them without them knowing. And they would put a marshmallow, a nice, big, fluffy, juicy, beautiful marshmallow smelling nice. And they bring the kids before lunch and they're hungry. And they'd sit them down at a table and the person will say to them, listen, this marshmallow, it's your marshmallow. But if you wait until I go to my office and come back, I'll give you another one. Or you can eat it whenever you want. But if you can wait until I come back, I'll give you double. Now, they found that there were certain kinds of children. And this was done with 4, 5, 6-year-olds, right? Some children, before the guy walked out the door, it's gone. Mashallah. It's like, I ain't waiting for nothing. It's here. It's mine. I'm hungry. I'm taking it. That's it. And they were very impulsive and very, you know, they enjoyed it quickly. There were others who were a bit, in two minds. They'd lick it. They'd take a bit off the bottom and try to hide that they, you know, and they'd smell it, you know, all this kind of stuff. And then they put it back and, or they take a little bit of it. And there was a little bit of give and take. There were others, very few, about 10, 15%, who just looked at that marshmallow and they knew the moment they heard they would get double, they weren't going to touch that. And they would do things like turn their body, not looking at it. They would start singing to themselves or, you know, dramatizing things or push it away to the corner of the desk to help themselves overcome the urge and the impulse to have it right now. And that ability to delay gratitude became one of the things that they measured these students with over the next 40 years. So they looked at these kids to see what was the trajectory of their life, the resilience that they naturally had or that they were taught at home. What was the trajectory of it? Where did they end up? Well, guess what? And you and I would be able to now easily kind of come to terms with that, that those students who, young kids who were very impulsive, gobbled it up, couldn't hold themselves, they usually didn't fulfill their educational capacity to what they could have done. They didn't get advanced degrees or even graduate undergrad. They were people who bounced from job to job, from place to place, who were likely to come back home after having lived alone and not really settle. The other side of it, those 15% were the ones who became high flyers. And guess what? That pattern of behavior was also set by their parents. And of course, there were economic disparities and racial issues that came into it, because if you were a poor child, and you were, you know, you had to fight for scraps of food in your home and somebody's giving you a marshmallow, you've been trained to just take it now before your older brother comes and takes it or your dad drinks the juice that's in the fridge. So there were different, you know, things like that. But in general, resilience and the ability to control oneself in moments of hardship and difficulty is something that can be trained and something that you can put in yourself. And that's what Allah does with us. Through fasting, through waking up for fajr, through praying and departing from our workplace to make sure that we're able to attend the Jumu'ah. All of these are things that build a level of resilience. So when a person is feeling that they are just not right, they're feeling blue, they're feeling down, something is not as it should be in their life, and there's reason for it, and they want to help themselves, and they notice somebody in their life who's in that condition and they want to help them. Let's speak first about how to help ourselves. So the first number one step is to prioritize your relationships with others. So make sure you do not isolate yourself. Make sure you do not disconnect. And that's why our faith is a very communal faith. We pray in the masjid when we can. And therefore, you know, when you find it unable to attend the masjid in COVID and unable to do tarawih during the month of Ramadan last year, which subhanAllah was difficult for many people in many parts of the world where they were affected by this, right? Because our faith is communal. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides us to a similar situation in the Quran. When Pharaoh was governing the people of Musa and Musa came to deliver them, Pharaoh ordered that nobody could leave their homes. So Allah says, "Ij'alu buyutakum qibla," turn your household into a qibla. And they had to adapt, right? So adaptability is a part of that resilience. But you prioritize your connections with your phone, with your internet, with your group chats, with your WhatsApp, Telegram now, right? MashaAllah, there's been this exodus, MashaAllah. Okay. Everybody left the dark side, came to the Noor, MashaAllah. Wait until they hear about Signal, right? Anyway, so, you know, prioritize relationships, prioritize your connection with people. And if you're not in a group, join a group. And if you're not with one, actively join for something that you can belong to and something maybe that is opposite to what you've been normally doing and normally had as a part and process and habits in your day-to-day lifestyle. So join and commit to an activity that connects you with other people, whether you know them or whether you will get to know them. That becomes important. Research in the area of organizing yourself, prioritizing relationships, connecting with family and beyond family shows that this is one of the best ways to help oneself come out of feeling blue. Another one is what is referred to as generally, you know, foster wellness and try to, you know, there's a lot of talk about wellness and self-care and take care of your body, but that's a sunnah. The Prophet ﷺ says, "Inna li badanika alayka haq." Your body has a right over you. As much as Allah has a right over you, "Inna li zawjika alayka haq." Your wife has a right over you. Your body has a right over you. Your friends have a right over you. Your community has a right over you. "Wa inna li rabbika alayka haq." Your Lord has a right over you. So you must sleep well and eat well and drink and hydrate well and exercise well. In my country of origin, Egypt, I remember, you know, growing up, my grandmother, she would scold me. I was a little bit tubbier when I was, you know, a few years ago. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala yudim alayna hadhihi ni'ma ya rab. It was a big struggle, you know, to drop a considerable amount of weight. But it's something that's always on my mind. My grandma, she would say, "Yahya, al-aql al-salim fi al-jism al-salim." A good mind, a sharp intellect, a sharp, clear thought can only come from a healthy body. You got to move. Al-haraka baraka. Wallahi, my grandma, Allah yarhamha ya rabbu, anzil ala qabriha al-diya'a wal-nur. She would say, "Yahya, movement gives baraka, gives you energy, gives you the ability to be a mover and a shaker," right? That's how we talk about life. What is life? What is the concept of haya? Meaning, hayyatun tas'a, something that has movement. The difference between a asa and a hayya in the desert was they both look like branches. A asa is a branch, a timber on the floor. What's the difference between that black thing that looks like a snake or it could be a branch? Is it hayya? It's hayya, meaning it moved, then it's a snake, right? The concept of haya is movement in our Arabic and Islamic context, right? So take care of your body. I know it's a buzzword. I know you hear people saying it, but it's something that becomes important for you to have a physical mindset that you're concerned with your physical body and an emotional taking care of your body, taking care of your heart, taking care of your mind, and an intellectual exercise and stimulation and reading and connecting and reading something that you haven't ever studied before, right? And, you know, there's different apps that kind of summarize books for you, or you can listen to the books being read. All of these are different things that are important. Having proper nutrition. I thought I'd just mention three verses that have been valuable to me, inshallah, in my journey. The first ayah, وَجَعَلْنَا مِنَ الْمَاءِ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ حَيٍّ. Everything that has been given life, that walks and moves around this earth, in one way or another, connects itself to water. And as much water as you think you're drinking, you're not drinking enough. Right? You're not drinking enough. So hydrate yourself. Kuli washrabi wa qarri ayna. Allah says to Maryam alayhi salam, drink, eat and drink and find your mindfulness and contentment. That's, you know, it's a step, right? We talk about soul food and things like that. Kuli waj'alna min al-ma'i kulla shay'in hayy. Number two, kulu washrabu wa la tusrifu. Eat, drink, but don't go to excess. Don't ever hold yourself back and say, "Oh no, I can't have this, it has too many calories." Take a bite, take two. You will never be able to have a self-discipline and self-control that you will never enjoy sugar again or sweets again or, you know, these kind of... No, be balanced. Don't be excessive in your negligence or in your addition. And third, Allah says, وَجَعَلْنَا اللَّيْلَ لِبَاسًا. The night was destined for sleep. I'm not talking about those who are doing shift work or are forced into it or whatever. I'm talking about in general, you should make your body heal in your night sleep. Your body only creates new cells, only detoxifies, only removes those kind of things, and our medical doctors can educate us more when you are sleeping at night. And the sunnah of sleep, of course, was in a dark room, put out the lights. The Prophet would say, turn out any of your candles and all this, so that it was pitch black in the house of the Prophet ﷺ when there was time to sleep. Your body, as much as it enjoys the sun by day, relishes and craves the darkness by night, right? So learn how to sleep, learn the sunnah of sleep, learn about our food intake and nutrition becomes important. Practice salah. Notice how I said practice salah. I didn't just say pray. I'm saying practice it. Like sallu kama ra'aytumuni usalli. Try to improve your salah. Try to add a new sunnah as you go along, as you become better and better. Try to learn new verses that you're going to recite. Try to know the meaning of the verses that you're going to recite. Read the translation before you do your salah. Oh, this is, I'm going to read amma yatasa'alun, and I'm going to remember a little bit about its meaning before I begin my salah. All these kind of things become a part of practice, but they increase your mindfulness and they take your mind off some of the other things that may be distracting you from your connection to Allah. Avoid negative outlets. So avoid gossip sessions, avoid going out with the wrong people, avoid sleeping excessively, avoid self-harm by running too much or going to the gym too much or not eating and those kind of things. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect all of us. Allahumma ameen. Another important category, and I don't want to take too much in the discussion, but I want to give enough information that you can then go forward with it, inshallah. So we said first, you know, have a focus on yourself, prioritize yourself. Number two is find purpose. So you need something to wake up for, right? And my purpose and your purpose don't have to be the same, but they will include similarities. So one purpose that I have, maybe you can have, is help others, right? So I'm taking time out of my day to speak with my dear brothers, my dear sisters in different parts of the world. And I'm you know, putting in this effort because I want to help others. That what do I get from this? Is that the thought that inshallah, even if it's one person who puts into practice something that I've shared that helps them with their life, Allahu Akbar, that is light for me on the day of judgment through the help of others. And Allah promises me, مَا دَامَ الْعَبْدُ فِي عَوْنِ أَخِيهِ كَانَ اللَّهُ فِي عَوْنِ. The Prophet ﷺ says that Allah promised that when a person commits himself to helping others, Allah becomes their aid. Allah becomes the one who assists them. Number two, in helping others, and what you say, what do you mean by helping others? So, you know, it could be that you volunteer, that you cook for others, and you say, brother, I can barely cook for myself. Well, learn, you know, get yourself doing something, right? Check in on your neighbor, make a call to your aunt, you know, do something. It doesn't have to be something significant for it to be worthwhile, right? Get yourself out there in support of your friends, you know, ask about them, do something tangible. And if all that you got is a nice smile, تَبَسُّمُكَ فِي وَجْهِ أَخِيكَ صَدَقَ بِوَجْهٍ طَلِقٍ, meet others with a good face and a good demeanor, even though there's a hardship that you're experiencing, show your resilience and show that you can be a support of others. Number two in this category is be proactive. Don't wait. Don't wait for people to say, I need help. Be proactive, right? And acknowledge and accept that your emotions are going to go up and down during hard times. Be proactive in seeking to help yourself through the help of others and finding purpose. And, you know, you can ask yourself, well, what can I do about this problem? How can I change this problem for this person? Or how can I change my own problems? And there's powerful hadith in that regard in the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam of fixing the pain of others as being the root cause of healing and finding closure and assistance in moving forward with the pain that we have. Move consistently towards a goal, finding a purpose, and you know, it could be a degree. And you might say, oh, you know, I got to work part-time. Okay, but don't give up. Always continue moving forward. Don't leave it off. Don't just abstain from it. There's always a movement forward. There's always something that I'm moving forward. And whether it's memorizing the whole Quran before you pass away, and it might take you 40 years, it took the Prophet ﷺ 23 years, and nobody's better than him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, right? No Sahaba, exceeded the love of the Prophet ﷺ. But Allah said, "Nuthabbita bi fu'adak," and as you keep moving, as you move towards your goal, you will feel a sense of accomplishment. And that's why you'll hear people say, you know, you want to attain goals quickly in each and every day. Making your bed in the morning, I've done it. Checklist, done. Ironing my shirts or my pants, or, you know, it might seem like a random insignificant act, but it's something that you've ticked off. You've attained a goal, big or small, mashallah. Bismillah. Look for opportunities to learn and discover new things about yourself. And subhanAllah, there are talents that we all have that we didn't know we had. And there are things that we are capable of that we never thought we can do. So learn more about yourself. Get more touchy-feely, my brother, right? You know, the sisters, mashallah, they might be a little bit better with that. But there's no shame in you and I, you know, picking up art. And, you know, I said this once to the brother in the masjid. I said, so how many of you guys, mashallah, who wants to start an art class? And they looked at me sideways. They're like, Sheikh, come on, man. And subhanAllah, you know, there's some budding artists, man, learning calligraphy, akhi. You know, just learning the script of the Quran. Right? Wallahi. One of the things, I wish it was nearby. You know, I have a mushaf. And you can buy this, right? You can buy a blank mushaf. So it looks like a mushaf, but it's blank on the inside. The page is bordered, and it's the same as the Medina mushaf. You could get the A3 size, the big size, or the smaller size. And the first few pages, it has the writing faded out, and then you start fading it in. And then you get to, I think it was like page 10 of Surah Al-Baqarah, the page is blank. And then you begin scripting it. So you write your own kind of Quran, and you try, obviously you're going to try your best. So you do it with pencil first, and then you go back over with a fine liner. But it's art, man. Art isn't, Sufi boofy kind of stuff, man. You can enjoy your art as a Muslim. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam appreciated beauty. The Sahaba appreciated beauty. They appreciated, and Muslims appreciated the mastery of geometric designs and so on. Connect to things that you never thought were there for you. Now, let's talk about dealing sometimes with our emotions, and I'll end with this, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. With whatever you encounter in life, keep things in perspective. And I don't want you to misunderstand me or think that, people say, Sheikh, you don't know what I'm dealing with. Akhi, you don't know what I'm going through. You don't know the pain I'm in. But I want you to understand how you think about something allows you to frame how you can deal with it and how you can move forward with it. So learning to keep things in perspective, to compartmentalize things, and I'm speaking to the sisters in particular, becomes an important art. Learning to, hold ourselves and restrain our emotion is strength. It's the root of the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ in Sahih Muslim saying, the one who is shadid, laysa shadidu bis-sur'a, the one who has strength isn't the one who can pin people down. وَلَكِنَّ الشَّدِيد مَن تَمَلَّكَ. Look at this. The one who's strong, who's mighty, who's powerful, is the one who can control themselves at a moment of heightened anger, at a moment of heightened emotion. Allah describes Musa as being fearful. فَأَوْجَسَ فِي نَفْسِهِ خِيفَةً مُوسَى. Moses, when he came and stood in front of Fir'aun and, you know, the Egypt and the gold and all, and the armies, Musa stands, and Allah described that inside himself, internally, Musa was terrified. أَوْجَسَ فِي نَفْسِهِ, in himself, خِيفَةً, not خَوْف, خِيفَةً, deep-seated fear. قُلْنَا لَا تَخَفْ, Allah says, I said to him, don't be afraid. right? Don't be scared. I'm with you, right? So understand that what is inside can be governed and can be assisted with our remembrance of Allah. And that's why Allah says, أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنُ الْقُلُوبِ. It is through the remembrance of God that the heart can find peace, meaning it's through knowing Allah is a part of my life. Allah is here with me along this journey. Inni asma' wa ara, I hear and I see and I know the condition that you are in, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if you feel overwhelmed by a challenge, remind yourself that for whatever happens, it's not an indicator of what will the rest of your life be. You know, sometimes, oh, I didn't do well in my high school, that's it. I'm going to be a failure the rest of my life. I didn't get into the university or the college or whatever. Oh, I washed out of this or that and my life is over. Oh my God, my wife and I, we're not doing well. We're going to get a divorce. It's over. La. Put things in perspective and know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is always with us. Accept change. Subhanallah. Be willing to accept that there's certain things you want that are not going to happen. There's certain things you planned on. Allah's plan is different. And there's certain things that you were banking on, that you invested in, that you gave, I'll give my life for this and it's not going to happen. And that's qadar. And be willing to accept that. And finally, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to learn to be able to forgive ourselves for the past and learn from it. And to go beyond the shackles of what haunts us from the days of past and what has happened to us, that we are able to grieve but move past it and emerge stronger as a consequence of it. And such was the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He gave people those opportunities. Always seek help. And there's no shame in speaking to a clinician, to a doctor, to a psychologist, to being referred to a psychiatrist, and asking for help is the hallmark of a believer, right? Musa alayhi salam, he asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, oh my Lord, ij'alli waziran min ahli, send for me somebody from my family to carry the burden of this message to Pharaoh, Harun akhi, let it be my brother Harun, he knows who he wants. But he asked for help, although he's speaking to Allah Rabbul Izzah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Learning to ask for help is a phenomenal, phenomenal way of success. Many people, the root cause of the failures they experience in life is that they ask for help, but it was too late. They asked for help only after they needed to. They waited too long to say, I need help, help me. So if you feel that you need help, reach out. And if you see somebody who you think might need help, check in. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us, use us for good and the assistance of others in this life and in the next. Allahumma ameen. And I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants you and I clemency, forgiveness, peace and ease and comfort in whatever experiences that we have, in whatever traumas that we may see in life, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows you and I to pass through the fitan, the difficulties of trials and tests that are being experienced without a loss of our iman. We live at a time where the Prophet ﷺ warned, يُصْبِحُ الْمَرْءُ مُؤْمِنًا وَيُمْسِي كَافِرًا. There will be moments where a person in human history will rise up as a believer out of their bed, but by the time the night comes, they've lost their faith and they enter into sleep as an unbeliever. May Allah protect us from this, Ya Rabb. Allahumma la taj'al fitnatana fi dinina. Oh Allah, do not make our test in life and that of our family as a test in our faith and in our relationship with you. Wa salla wa salli Allahumma wa sallim wa zid wa barik ala sayyidina wa habibina wa nabiyina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim tasliman kathira. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
We have a couple of questions, inshallah, if you want to address those. I'm going to read out the questions, inshallah, and then maybe you can respond to them directly. The first question is when your parents ask you what you're doing on your phone, and you tell them that you're helping someone. They say that you can't help anyone till you help yourself. And does that mean that the person you were helping got helped or not?
So there's a famous statement in Arabic folklore that says, فَاقِدُ الشَّيْءِ لَا يُعْطِي. The one who possesses nothing cannot give something in return. So sometimes our parents, they assume of us that we don't have the skills to help somebody else because they see maybe that there's certain things that we need help in. What I will say to you is your parents, alhamdulillah, okay, let me not talk about parents. In general, in life, people are going to always underestimate our value towards others. And in general, in life, you will overestimate your importance in the life of others. So I want this to be something that you kind of think about as a younger person. In life, people are always going to underestimate your value, your worth, your input, the things you do for other people. And in your own perspective, you're going to think that you're more important in other people's lives than you actually are. What would they do without me at my workplace if I left? Or, you know, where would, you know, how would things be? So what I want to say is have a balance in that regard. If your parents are seeing you and telling you, listen, you're spending too much time, effort, money, hours working on other people's problems, and there are problems that you need to address for yourself, perhaps they're seeing something that you're not able to see in your own in your own self. So I would tell you to take what your parents say as a general admonition that there could be improvements and processes of you becoming more active in your own life, in the betterment of your own condition, so that you can be helpful and more helpful to others into the future, inshallah.
Then we have a next question, which is going to be, it says, is it better to try to learn everything when you are a kid or adult?
It's important to always have a lifelong journey with knowledge. So you want to continue learning until the very end. SubhanAllah, I'll use myself as an example. I'm a young 44-year-old man, mashallah. I like to emphasize the word young, alhamdulillah. And I'm still engaged in learning as much so, maybe even more so than when I was in my 20s. Knowledge is a lifelong pursuit. So develop within yourself the capacity of wanting to learn, as was the sunnah and the habit of the Prophet ﷺ. وَقُلْ رَبِّ زِدْنِي عِلْمًا. It's the only place in the Quran where Allah says to the Prophet to increase him in something he already has. The Prophet has knowledge, but Allah says, ask me for more. Because that's the one thing that everybody needs more of. وَقُلْ رَبِّ زِدْنِي عِلْمًا. So always aspire to gathering more knowledge, learning more, practicing more of what you know, inshallah. Bismillah.
JazakAllah khairan, Sheikh. We have another question. Ask, can you discuss the concept of therapy and why there is a taboo behind it and behind mental health in our community?
Sorry, you broke out there a little bit. Can you repeat that section? I heard, can you discuss therapy, but I didn't hear what came after.
Yes, can you discuss therapy and why there is a taboo behind mental health in our own communities?
So one of the sad realities is that there is a stigma and a self-stigma. So you might want to read a piece that I wrote on this, and it's actually timely. It might help those who do have diagnosed mental health issues to prepare for the month of Ramadan. So I have a piece that is published with muslimmatters.org. It's called mental health in Ramadan, or something, you know, I wrote it a few years ago, but it speaks a little bit about the stigmatization, the self-stigmatization, and how we can go beyond that as a community. So I do refer you to that as the first part of the answer. But a lot of the stigma is really in the minds of those who feel people will look at them in that way because they've heard others using derogatory terms, oh, this person Majnoon, or this person's unwell, or, you know, and so on. There does need to be a cultural shift within our Islamic communities, within our Arabic communities, within our ethnic communities, where we do have this slur, where we speak about someone who is unwell for a point in time that can be fixed by medicine or developing good habits or counseling or clinical interventions, that they suffer for years, because if people know that I'm seeing a doctor or seeing someone that I speak to, it'll become a huge problem for me. People are, you know, my kids won't get married. My brother, my sister who's unmarried is going to have problems, and people are going to make fun of us, and so on. What I will say to you is, your self-care is a priority. Number two, imams and community leaders need to be much more outward in the encouragement of our communities to take up these types of courses and enroll our young Muslims into clinical psychology programs at university, into sociology, into youth service work, into these type of humanities courses and clinical courses that will have a great impact on the changes that we want for our community in the future. It is such a noble pursuit to be able to look after somebody's mental health and be able to assist them from an Islamic perspective as well. And when we see that support being provided, then it becomes much more encouraging for people to come forward and say, you know what, my mom and I, we really do need to see a counselor. My mother-in-law and I, we're not getting well. Maybe if we spoke to someone, we can undo the years of resentment that have been built that may lead us to divorce if we don't get it sorted. Because the reality is, a lot of the divorce that occurs within our communities, I can tell you this as a minister of religion, as a celebrant who officiates marriages, as somebody who's a licensed mediator and assists in the courts as it relates to, you know, people dissolving their marriages. A lot of it goes back to mental health issues that haven't been taken care of. And if they were taken care of, then you will find that stability can be found. Sometimes it's a chemical intervention with a medicine that's taken. Sometimes it's just learning routines that can assist with obsessive compulsive disorders. Sometimes it's learning to cooperate with others. All of these are things that become really, really life-changing when a person moves forward with it. So I'm committed to trying to end stigmatization of mental health issues. It's a constant topic that I address in my public forums here in Australia, in Perth in particular. It's something where I have a counselor and a psychologist who works very closely with me at my school to make sure that our children are supported and that they feel valued and that they can have an outlet to let their emotions and psychological state be heard. It is important, inshallah. Bismillah.
Inshallah. Jazakallah khairan. That was the last of our questions, inshallah. If you have any concluding remarks, if you want to make any maybe tips you can give people in these times, you can go ahead, inshallah.
Jazakumullah khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Inshallah, Jazakumullah khair, and Sheikh Yahya, and everybody.